The goal of this lecture course, mini lecture course, is to give an introduction to Jan Baxter maps. So that's a work in collaboration with Sergei Sergeyev. So what's the, I just briefly repeat what's the goal, okay? So the goal we have is to understand the classification of discrete integrable system. That's a very popular topic and many people work on it. And we want to present a different point of view. So, because we want to start from the quantum case, from most of the people who work on discrete integrable system work on classical system. So, but what we want to do is to start with quantum system and obtain classical system in the quasi-classical limit when the Planck constant goes to zero. So well, the main reason we want to do that, and that we want to preserve the canonical structure of the system. So from my point of view, the evolution is the canonical transformation of the generalized coordinate and momenta. So so it is a that's the side of the side of the description which is usually either missed in the traditional approach or very difficult to it's very difficult to get it. Okay, so that was the motivation. So we start with the quantum case and when we got the classical limit. Okay, so I skipped the so what's the basic ingredients? The basic ingredient is so-called Jan Baxter map. Okay. So we have a set, two identical sets, he and he. We take a Cartesian product of two sets, and R by definition is a map from a product to a product. Okay. So, and the set theoretical or Jan Baxter equation is by definition, is this relation. And if the map satisfies this equation, it is called Jan Baxter map. So what is R12? R12, so the 1,3 and 2,3, is the we have three sets, direct product of three sets, and R12 act as this map on the first and second factor and leave the third factor unchanged. And secondly, and similarly, 1,3 and 2,3 are defined. Last time we had a discussion with Alex Molyv about what is set theoretical Jan Baxter equation. And actually we can continue that discussion. I looked in the papers by Ettinghoff and other people who worked on set theoretical Jan Baxter equation. And yes, they work with continuous sets which contain continuous variables, and so the most of the map they consider can be regarded as a map in a vector space. They have vector space, it's map direct product of vector space, and it's mapped to a vector space. Okay. So So that's the map. And as I explained last time, it's something which is a well-known, or maybe is known under other names in the theory of discrete integrable system, in particular, so-called 3D consistency. So, and which was pushed forward by Adler, Babenka, and Suris. So we'll briefly discuss it a little bit later, but let me explain the main idea, how we will get solutions, examples of this map. So we take a quasi-triangular Hopf algebra, and by definition, it contains, so we can, algebra A, quasi-triangle Hopf algebra, and by definition, it contains an element which belongs to the direct product of the tensor product of two algebras, which is called universal R matrix, and it satisfies this relation. So the R is a map of product of two algebras, okay, into a product of two algebras. It's a linear operation. So to get a functional map, we have to consider adjoint action. So if we can see the adjoint action of this linear operator on the elements of the direct product, we'll get a functional map, which will satisfy this functional Jahn-Bachstad equation. Okay, so I would prefer to have questions from the audience, because it's very difficult, because I can't see your eyes. I don't see whether you understand or not, whether you're listening or not listening. So whom we have here? So many people. So
I have a question.
Yes.
It's Anthony Henderson here. Hi. I'm sure I've seen the definition of R matrix before, where the Jahn-Bachstad map was obtained by switching the factors and then applying the and then conjugating by the R matrix. So you seem to have different conventions here.
So there are two schools. Sometimes people prefer to write this equation, any Jahn-Bachstad equation, is what is called a braid, braid theory form. It looks like R12, R23, R12, and R23, R12, R23. So that is achieved by multiplying the R matrix, any of these, by the permutation operator. So it's just convention. It's a notational difference. Is it the question?
Yeah, so, that's right. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's just two schools. The physicists prefer work with this form. Half, or maybe less than half, of mathematicians prefer this braided form of the Jahn-Bachstad equation. So, but it will appear later in my talk. It will appear later. So, because in some equations, it's much more appropriate to use the other form, R matrix multiplied by permutation. So that is just the rough idea what we do. Okay. So I skip this. So we start with our example. And the main example of the quasi-triangular Hopf algebra is universal enveloping algebra, which is denoted by the symbol UQ of SL2. So, well, it originates from SL2, but it's Q deformed. And what is universal enveloping? That we allow as element of this algebra any Taylor series, including infinite Taylor series, in the generators E and H. Another convenient basis is to work with element K, which is exponential infinite series in H. So that we have. So let me point, note that there is a quadratic Casimir operator, which commute with all elements of the algebra. So that is generating elements. And so the arbitrary element of the algebra is this sum of the products of these elements over the field of complex numbers. And Q is a formal parameter. And well, we'll think about this as a number, as some number, some complex number. So what is a Hopf algebra? Well, the main element of the Hopf algebra is so-called co-multiplication. What does it mean? If we have a map from the algebra to the tensor square of this algebra. Well, if you're speaking about SL2 or rotation group, it's a addition of angular momentum. If you have two angular momenta, their sum is also satisfy the same relation of the SL2 algebra. So this is co-multiplication, and here it is not what is called co-commutative. So you see that it is not symmetric on the permutation of the factors. So for SL2, it was co-commutative, but because this element k, q to the h, basically for SL2, there would be, the formula will be symmetric under the permutation of two factors, but he is not co-commutative. And well, that was a main achievement at the time the quantum groups were introduced. I remember a lecture of Drinfield, who said that previously there were examples of non-commutative and non-co-commutative algebra, but they would be better called counterexamples. So they were so unnatural, so the Drinfield prefer to call them counterexamples. So, but with this deformation of the classical Lie algebra, so there are many of them, so the family of deformations for infinite series of these algebras. So that is, that's a general theory now. So I will concentrate on this algebra, but most of the equations are most equations hold for any case. Okay, so there are also co-unit and antipod, which won't play any role today, so I skipped that point. And so now why it is called quasi-triangular? So the by definition, there exists an element R, which belongs to the direct product of two algebras, which satisfy these defining relations. Satisfy these defining relations, and so delta is a co-multiplication, and delta prime is defined here is co-multiplication with swapped factor. Sigma is just permutation operators. Okay, I told you that co-multiplication is not co-commutative, so that if you swap factor, is it doesn't go to itself, it goes to something different, which called delta prime. And these two operations are linear, related by linear transformation. So we can put that factor R, multiply by R minus one from the right. So it will be R minus one here. So what does it say? Delta prime is just swap the factors in the co-product or apply similarity transformation with this element and we achieve the same effect. So because sigma is operation which doesn't belong to the product of algebra. We cannot just swap the factors. There are no such element in the product of two algebras, but we have an element R. And so we make a joint action with this element, and that effect is to swap the factors. So, yeah, I have, so, and what are these other relations? So R is the element of the direct product of two algebras, okay? And what does it mean? Delta cross one. So that means that we apply delta to the first factor in this product and do nothing with the second factor. Okay. And as a result, so R was an element of a product of two, but when we apply delta, because delta is a map from the algebra to a product, we got three factors. And now we number them 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. And R1, 3 is the element which belong to the first and third and so on. So, well, that is, so maybe, well, I prepared some pictures. So what is it? So, I made a mistake. Instead of bold face R, I started to write here the curly, calligraphic R. That's a mistake. So on these drawings, R is the bold face R. Okay, so the same R we had just had before. It belongs to the direct product of two algebra. It's element of the direct product. So, to understand this relation, you use graphical notation. So a line is the algebra, the second algebra another line, and that is R here. So delta is the map from algebra to two algebra. So it's mapping one line to two lines. So we have R here, which are two lines, and we apply delta in the first factor. That means that this line, this first line, will be doubled. You see? So graphical, I explain graphical notation. So, and that we got that relation. So we can read it off from the picture. So that operation applied to R give us product of R13 and R23. And there are three algebras here. Okay. And so similar. If you apply delta prime in the first factor, so, well, we know that delta prime is the same as delta, but we need to just multiply the permutation, swap the factors. So we do as before, 1, 2, but we swap them here and we got 2, 1. Okay. So now we remember that delta prime is given by this, satisfy this relation. So we proceed as before, we swap the factors, or we can proceed as before, okay? So that is delta. Yes, we can use this form, so this picture. So delta prime is the similarity transformation of delta, so we do this first. That is this bit. And now we multiply by R from two sides. And that is the same as the result we got here. Okay, with using permutation explicit. Well, so if we now multiply by R12 from the right, remove it from here, it will reappear here. What we get Jahn-Baxter equation. So yes, I repeat that that's a misprint. I noted it very late. I didn't have time to correct that. R on all these handwritten pictures should be boldface R. It's not the map, it's the linear operator. So, and maybe a small remark on the pictures. So the picture of the Jahn-Baxter equation we have is the lines and the R matrices are on the intersection of the lines, okay? And the algebras, three algebras associated with the lines. So we can make a duality transformation in geometric set. Replace faces, all faces, with the, including semi-infinite faces, with the point, with the vertex. Okay. Replace edge by edge, and replace vertices by faces. So I made duality transformation. So now the algebras, algebra one, associated with the faces. Okay. So that's the dual picture. So we can draw the R matrix as a cross or the face. But the algebras associated will be correspond to the faces. So, and so two pictures. One picture is two triangles, and the second picture is two hexagons. They look like three faces of three-dimensional cube, front faces and back faces. Okay, so what I explained before. Okay, so I explained you just that these defining relations, they imply the Jahn-Baxter equation. So the Jahn-Baxter equation in this formulation is not fundamental relation. It's a consequence of a simple, I would say simpler relation. So the algebra of UQSL2 is relatively simple. So we can actually write that element R explicitly. It's important to understand that is not uniquely defined as an element of the direct product of two algebras, but if we assume that it belongs to the product of Borel subalgebras generated by H and F and H and E. When it is uniquely defined, then the formula is simple. So all these factors commute, infinite number of factors, but they commute with each other, because E commute with E and F with F. So it's a formal product. It's a formal product. So there are no question of the convergence of this product and so on. And of course, these questions will arise if we try to construct representation, use particular representations of the algebra when we need to examine the convergence and so on. So what I explained last time is the how to, well, we can actually now rewrite this formula as a map. As a map. So we have product of two algebras. But every element of the algebra can be expressed in terms of generators, which is, we choose K, E, and F. Okay. X1 denote the set of generators in the first factor, X2 set of generators in the second factor. So the map here, of course, to the first instance, we need to know how it maps the generators, how it maps these two guys. And so we apply the simulated transformation. And I explained last time, but I won't repeat. It's like straightforward, I would say, straightforward calculation. You just use this formula, explicit form of the R matrix, and you get the map for generators. But once you know the map for generators, you can recalculate this map because arbitrary element of the algebra is the sum of the products of generators. So if you know, and the map is linear transformation. So the sum of the products go to sum of the products. So we can calculate the map for any element of the algebra. Okay. Well, I would say it's already quite complicated formula, even for the simplest algebra UQSL2. And the idea is to use, well, what we got, this map, to formulate some dynamical system. So we want to use this map as a local equation of motion for some dynamical system. Okay, what else I explained? Yes, how we formulate this dynamical system. So Jan Baxter map act on the tensor square of two algebras. So it's a direct product, but I supplied the additional indices, one and two. It's not necessary. We know that the first factor is first, second factor is second, but it's just simplify the understanding when we have many of them. So we'll take our algebra of observables to be the direct product of two n copies of this algebra. Okay, so let me remind what we have. If you have classical mechanics, the state of the system is a point in the phase space. The phase space is a set of coordinate and momenta or coordinate and velocities, but I prefer Hamiltonian formulation. So we have a phase space with coordinates and momenta, generalized coordinates and momenta, and the states are points in this space, in this vector space. So in quantum case, and the observables in classical system are the function of the points in the phase space. So if we want to calculate some observable, the energy, we take the our state, I can calculate everything. So in quantum case, it's a little bit more complicated. The states of the system are vectors in Hilbert space. So they're one-dimensional subspaces of the Hilbert space, but observables are operators which act as operator in the Hilbert space. Okay. Well, we can we have two pictures, Heisenberg picture where we trace evolution of the state or wave function of the system, or Heisenberg picture where we trace evolution of the observable. So, but in any case, in quantum system, we have algebra of observables. So in the simplest case of one particle, it's coordinate and momentum. They have two operators which do not commute. In classical case, they commute and can be measured simultaneously, but in quantum case, they do not commute. So, what I take as an algebra of observables is a direct product of two entropies of the algebra. What's the motivation? The algebra A is generated by three elements, E, F, and H, or E, F, and K. So, but they're a quadratic Casimir element. So, that means there are two independent operators. So the quadratic Casimir commute with everything. So it looks like we have two non-commuting variables like a coordinate and momentum, and for each of these algebras. So by counting the degree of freedoms, we're saying that we have two operators in each of them. So we have two multiplied by two and four n operators. Okay. Half of them is like coordinates, generalized coordinates, and half of them are momenta. So that's probably the answer to the question that Anthony asked before. That's R hat. So I take the map and multiply, take a composition with permutation operator. So Rij means our map, which act in the factor A and J for algebra with the index I and J. Okay. So, and we define the following map. We take the product of this map. So the first one, R12, is just this map in the first and second factor, and we swap them. 2, 3 is the third and fourth factor. So, and after we do that with all consecutive pairs, we apply this another operation which cyclically shift the factors in the product. Okay, it's more, maybe difficult to understand, but I prepared the picture. So I used here the dual picture. So where the R matrix, in this case, it's not R matrix, it's the map, functional map, represented by this square or rhombus or parallelepiped, whatever you want to prefer, quadrilateral. And the algebra one, algebra two, and their images under the map. So R with hat will have the same picture, but one prime and two prime will be swapped. Okay. So now we have our algebra of observables here, direct product of A1, A2, A3, A2n. And we apply the map to the first one and second one, third and fourth, and so on. Now, we apply the map with R hat. So somehow hat disappeared from that picture. I don't know why. And so what I explained, R hat will have A1, and A1 prime here. Here we would have A1, A1 prime, but remember I said we cyclically shift all indices. So to the left. So A1 prime went to here. And A2 from here to here. And A3 from here to here, and so on. So we apply these pairwise maps, and when cyclically shift. And that shift makes the things non, and that is a image, what will happen to the our algebra of observables after one step. So we now consider that map as an evolution operator for one step of discrete time.
Yeah, Vladimir, can I ask a question?
Of course, of course.
Yeah, my question is that there was a formula for your operator,
mm-hmm.
which I understand well.
Yeah.
Now you're showing some pictures.
Yeah.
Is it necessary to understand these pictures? Or I can ignore the pictures, I understand the formula, and go ahead.
No, you don't have to understand the picture. So, but some people do not understand formulae, they understand only pictures. And also some people, if they look to the formula, okay, and you ask them to draw the picture, they draw the picture which you do not expect. That usually what happens with my co-author Sergeyev. If he draw the picture, from my point of view, everything upside down, and you need to take a mirror image and so to understand the picture. So I understand your confusion. So I perfectly understand.
May I insert a comment to say I appreciate the pictures. I really like them. They help me understand.
Okay, so we have vote. We have a vote in the audience. Now, even if I try to write the product of two matrices A, B, okay, I put A to the left of B, but some people put B to the left of A. Okay, so if you understand this, so this map define what I call one step evolution of discrete time. By construction, it preserves tensor product structure. Okay. So we have algebra A in each side of the line, and we have algebra A, each or all of these algebra are isomorphic. So from the algebraic point of view, it's a evolution automorphism, like it should be for quantum mechanical system. So the motion is a canonical transformation. We cannot change commutation relation between observables. So they stay the same at every moment of time. So, well, the structure which I presented, yes, in the, well, quite natural for discrete system, of course, but for continuous systems, which we might touch at the end, that the name of such structure is called ultra-local structure. So what we have, okay, so now I want to explain why this system which I defined will be integrable. Okay, and I will try to argue with the Liouville type ideas, so the Liouville definition of integrability, so that that we have a sufficient number of mutually commuting integrals of motion, whose joint eigenspector uniquely define stationary states of the system. So these sets of integral, of course, should contain Hamiltonian of the system, and so the that's one of the integrals, but the rest of them allow you to obtain all stationary states once you diagonalize the commuting integrals. So that's a loose definition, Liouville definition, intuitive definition of integrability. So I just briefly repeat what I explained last time. Universal matrix is not uniquely defined, as I noted, but if B minus B plus, it satisfies and satisfy the definition of the universal matrix, when so does the element which is inverse and with 1-2 swapped. It will automatically belong to B plus B minus product. And you can take the Young-Baxter equation we had before, multiply, use this formula, and rewrite it in many forms, so which involve R star. Well, from conceptual point of view, this guy is not in any sense worse than the original one. So we could have started with this one, but what I'm trying to say, we need to use both of them. And so what we do with this, we now calculate specialization of this element. Oh, we had an explicit expression for it. For the two-dimensional, and I call it spin 1/2 representation of UQSL2. So this simple representation is actually up to the factors, is the same as the representation of SL2. Okay. So if you do that in the first factor and do nothing with the second factor and apply to the matrix R, universal matrix will go get 2x2 matrix whose elements belong to the algebra, second factor here. Okay. It's an algebra. So it's E, F, and H. And it is simple. And here, I don't need to assume much about that formula. So I assume that Q is a complex number, and less than whose modulus is less than one. So if you now, I don't want to explain, but you can trust me that this formula, where is it? Yes, that will be convergent series. So it's easy to calculate. If it is two dimensional, that e square is zero, so that product become a sum of these elements, and if q less than one, absolute value of q less than one, that you need to calculate a convergent series. Geometric series, okay. So already he is a not formal parameter; is a number. So if you do it with the same with L minus, we'll get this matrix, and we now can specialize the Jahn-Baxter equation. So what we do, we'll well, after some renormalization, basically we make one of these spaces two dimensional. And so when the that equation imply this, for example. And what does it mean here? L is 2x2 matrix, whose elements are element of the algebra. What does it mean? So we multiply them as matrices, as 2x2 matrices, but the elements take the direct product. So the elements of this guy are in algebra one, elements of this guy in algebra two, they formally commute, but we remember that they in a different factor of the product. And what does it mean? So if we now apply similarity transformation, which act in two factors, or we swap the indices here, or the change the order of the matrix multiplication. We can write this the same without one and two in formal notation, but I prefer this formula that it's more intuitive, easy to work with. So now the Jahn-Baxter map. And let L1 plus minus and L2 plus minus be the same form, the same quantities, L plus minus, but conjugated by the map R1. Okay. When we can rewrite, so we're saying that we apply R12 here to the first one, to the second one, and denote them by this formula. So what does it mean? So if we take this formula and substitute in it this map for one and for two, so you have this two. So we get L plus tilde, L minus tilde. But what is L plus and L minus? Well, it's 2x2 matrices, but the elements are elements of the algebra of observables. So we applied the evolution operator roughly, our evolution operator on two sides, and got these guys. So that means that L1 tilde and L2 tilde are just the same guys, L1 and 2, but the next moment of time. And now I rewrite this relation in this form, and I say that if I take the product and in the initial time, and next moment of time, one step of time evolution, so I just swap the factors. That is, and we can get another relations of this form. And for example, this relation is written here. You see, we have elements and we apply the map here, now time evolution, and we got this matrix. And that is the same because of equation of motion. So it resembles what is called zero curvature condition. So remember, the algebras associated with the, our observables associated with the edges in this one. So we have L minus, L plus along this path, and the other side of the relation, next moment of time, we have this part. That was, I explained what is L plus and L minus, and L plus L minus was specialization in the first space. Now I go further and specialize the second space, also spin 1/2 representation. So when this element become just 4x4 matrix, it's 2x2 block matrix, each block is 2x2 matrix. And we can form the linear combinations of these R plus and R minus, and they satisfy these relations. Okay, and actually, that all specializations of the equations, what we have for universal R matrix, that is called R matrix form of the commutation relation. So if you look at these relations, so this symbol, the direct product with the dot, means that we take tensor product acting in different factor of C2 and C2 and operator product of the matrix cell. It's a different, so we took different. So we now take direct product as matrices or operator product for the elements. So, but anyway, so that's a redefinition of the, it's a rewriting of the all our equation, but you can check that these relations are equivalent to commutation relation between the elements of the UQSL2. Okay, and we can write it in form of parameter dependent Young-Baxter equation, and finally, co-multiplication is just for this L operator L plus minus is reduced to the direct product. Okay, so direct product for the matrix elements and matrix product as 2x2 matrices. Well, maybe I finish at this point, and next time I'll explain finally the integrals of motion, and we'll work with particular representations and formulate some interesting physics.
Well, thank you. Whatever, any questions?
I have a kind of I don't quite know whether it's meaningful in this context, but a question about Lax pairs.
Yes.
In the usual, I suppose, interpretation of lattice equations, which is not the Young-Baxter interpretation, there is a straightforward way of producing a linear problem by looking at the embedding in three dimensions and linearizing the third equation that you get in that extra dimension. How can we interpret that here? Is that something you will be covering, something that's like lattice pairs?
Well, that's a very good question. And that's usually the question which I ask to people when I listen to their talk about. Many times I ask that question to Suris, Babenka, Adler, and other people in connection with their classification. And so my understanding, sometimes they can get, and not only them, people can get lax representation for equation of motion, but it's ad hoc. I never understood how it is done. Maybe you teach me, and I'll think about this again. But that's the question which is constantly in my mind.
Okay.
So basically, the short answer, I do not understand. I don't know how to answer your question. I know some constructions, but from my point of view, they're not genuine.
I see. Okay, so thank you.
The people in any particular case, they invent something, but there are a few. A system, for example, with the same guys, Adler, Babenka, and Suris, for which they do not know.
Yeah.
Do not know the lax representation and do not know Hamiltonian structure.
I see.